Thank you all for coming. It's my great pleasure to welcome you to Doughty Street Chambers. Here we've always operated as a multidisciplinary set, and our aim tonight is to show that we can offer a far wider range of advice and representation than other chambers, many chambers these days, without a single specialisation. This evening we're going to be looking at how to use the civil law in cases that at least start or have a connection to the criminal context. It's a bit wider to how to sue the police, but that's the rather snappier headline. It breaks down into two areas. One, perhaps, which we're counterintuitively going to do first, is the second area, what to do after criminal litigation. So if one has had a thundering triumph to trial, or a notable triumph in the appeal, and your client turns to you, ask the obvious question, can I sue them? Well, with the help of Heather Williams and Quincy Whitaker, we're going to consider just that question. But we also here have specialisation in using the civil courts pre-criminal litigation, and that's primarily challenging things like search warrants. And Rupert, who sits to my far right, has a specialisation in that, and he for a third of our speakers, he will set out some of the rules and ideas and some thoughts about that. The plan is everyone speaks for about 15 minutes, and then we'll have 10 or 15 minutes of questions and contributions. So I'll move straight on to the mic and invite Heather to start us off talking about how you see it.
Thank you very much, Joel. Good evening, everyone. Anyone who's seen the recent video recording on the Dash Street YouTube channel involving Joel and myself will know that we very much enjoy in these chambers having a conversation about how to sue the police. But one thing we like even better than having a conversation about how to sue the police is suing the police. And we do plenty of that as well. And it is, I believe, as an area I've been involved in for a long time, a really fascinating area of work with a particularly interesting mixture of challenging, difficult, novel legal points and also cases that are complex factually and can involve some pretty heavy cross-examination of police officers, jury advocacy and so forth. So it's an ideal mix between the two, if you like, both. And also, obviously, a lot of the cases involve important civil liberties and justice issues. As Joel said, I'm going to talk for about 15 minutes, so obviously, although my aim is to do an overview, I can't possibly cover an overview of the whole area in that time. I'm trying to focus in particular on questions that I often get asked by people who don't do actions against the police but are curious, and using that as a sort of testing ground for the kind of things that I should cover. I'm not going to speak to all the various slides, particularly the more dull ones. And please, other areas of interest to you that I haven't covered, do take the opportunity during question time or refreshments afterwards to ask away. Go to the first slide. So first of all then, perhaps the most obvious question, why civil litigation, the scenario that Joel's mentioned, your clients being acquitted in a criminal trial, prosecution have dropped the proceedings. Obviously some clients are just so relieved they want to walk away from that, and that's the end of the matter. Paddy and I should say that Paddy O'Connor is presenting this session at a second version of this seminar, and we've collaborated together on this paper, or this PowerPoint. Why civil litigation? One of the strongest reasons that comes across in talking to our clients is accountability and obtaining clear findings of police wrongdoing. Obviously somebody may be acquitted because the jury feels that the police have behaved in a rather murky way. But at the end of the day, beyond the acquittal, there are not going to be specific findings about police misconduct or anything of that nature. And to achieve accountability and vindication of the client's position is a huge part of civil action work. And something that in my experience, when we have a successful case, whether it's a reasoned judgment from a judge or a jury decision, clients do come away with a real sense of having achieved just that accountability. Many clients feel that the police complaints system is frustrating and ineffectual. That's not to say it doesn't have a place. In many instances, police complaints are made alongside civil actions. And if your client's priority is seeking to achieve disciplinary proceedings of officers, then clearly that's a potential line to go down. Also, there are some matters that simply don't fit within a legal cause of action, but a police officer has behaved, for example, rudely or discourteously to someone. It's going to be a police complaint rather than a civil action. The statistics are not encouraging. I've included the ones from 2014 to 2015, because in the 2015 to 2016, although the Independent Police Complaints Commission report gave various other statistics, they don't actually give the statistic of how many complaints were upheld, because they say they are considering how best to reflect that data. But I suspect it means the statistics aren't any better. But certainly in my experience, the complaints that are upheld tend to be the ones where there is no or little dispute of fact, but it's simply effectively an agreed version of events. But it's, for example, clear that in those circumstances there wasn't actually a power of arrest or something of that nature. As soon as you get a dispute of fact between client and police, very rare for police complaints to be upheld. In fact, even when there's CCTV or other independent supporting evidence. Why else civil litigation to obtain compensation is a priority for some clients, less so for others. The damages aren't necessarily huge in this area, more of in due course, but maybe a significant amount for the clients involved. And for a lot of clients, obtaining an apology, which may well be part of a settlement package of the action, is a significant priority. But obviously, there are some downsides as well. Proceedings are likely to be lengthy, they're likely to be stressful, for the clients at least, possibly the lawyers too. I think the next point is really important to stress, because it comes as a surprise to those who are well versed in criminal proceedings but relatively unfamiliar with civil actions against the police, and that is the degree of scrutiny that focuses upon the claimant as the person bringing the claim. I mean, at the trial, and perhaps particularly so in the jury trial, at any trial the claimant will give evidence first, but the defendant lawyers will think that they will get particular mileage in trying to discredit the claimant in a jury trial. And it is very common in a civil action jury trial for the defendant to devote a very considerable amount of time to cross-examining the claimant and basically bringing up anything they can dredge up in their previous forensic history, medical records, and so on. And they will have access to far more information of that kind than they could ever deploy in a criminal case. Also, it has to be said, most of the leading police defence barristers, which John Beggs, Queen's Counsel, is probably the primary exponent, are, you know, they're blooming good at it. They're very good at destroying credibility of claimants. And so, I mean, when I see a client or prospective client in conference, I always make it clear to them, if they are someone who is experienced in the criminal justice system, that it is going to be a wholly different ball game. And obviously we do our best to prepare them for what lies ahead. Nonetheless, very frequently, during or after trial, I had clients who said to me, okay, yeah, I remember in conference you said it was going to be like that, but I didn't really realise what it was going to be like until I experienced it. I had one client once who was being cross-examined a day and a half at least and wasn't doing very well. I mean, it's normally the low point of the case evidentially. And obviously I couldn't speak to him while he was giving evidence. And then at the end of it, he seemed a bit grumpy. So I sort of tried to make soothing noises about, you know, giving evidence is difficult and so on. And he said, well, you're not doing a very good job, are you? You're just sitting there. So I sort of thought, well, what else am I supposed to be doing while he's being cross-examined by, you know, experienced police barristers? So I politely sort of pointed that out. He said, in all the criminal trials I've been involved in, you know, my barrister's up questioning the police, tearing them to shreds. All you've done is sat there and, you know, watched me being picked on. So, I mean, I explained this, of course, I had explained before that time would come, as it duly did. But it's just an example of how I think claimants in civil actions do feel that the focus has turned on them in a way that they are not used to experiencing in criminal trials. So basically, I'm not saying don't bring cases if you haven't got a client with a pristine background, but it's just to be aware it does make a big difference. And it also impacts in this way that defendant police forces who have become more sophisticated in their thinking over the years will be much more ready to settle cases with claimants who are of good character and who otherwise they don't have discrediting material in relation to. The next slide, please. I mean, the next two I'm going to do because it's really just there as a sort of quick guide aid memoir for you as to the main causes of action that arise in relation to each aspect of policing and the criminal justice process. And in a few minutes, in any event, Quincy's going to be talking particularly about false imprisonment and malicious prosecution, which are two of the most common causes of action. And then if we go to the next slide, Rupert's going to be talking amongst other things about search and seizure of goods. And then if we go to the third slide in this section, I'll just say a couple more words here because we're not specifically covering these causes of action in detail tonight, but they also come up relatively frequently. Firstly, misfeasance in a public office. For those who are working in the criminal law area, basically think criminal offence and misconduct in public office, because the elements are, whilst they're not identical, they are very, very similar. And basically can apply in a wide range of circumstances if, and this is the big if, you can show that the officer in question is acting in bad faith and knew or was subjectively reckless as to the requisite kind of damage being caused to your client. Negligence I've also mentioned because over the years there have been a lot of cases in that area because police officers do act carelessly quite frequently, surprise, surprise. However, the difficult cause of action of limited value because the appellate courts have repeatedly held that there is no duty of care, the foundation which underpins a claim of negligence in relation to the investigation and suppression of crime, and that's been widely interpreted by the courts so that an awful lot of things that police officers do is apparently related to the investigation and suppression of crime. There are a few exceptions which I don't have time to go into, but that's the position generally. On the other hand, it is clear that a custodian owes a duty of care to those whom they detain, so negligence has proved quite a fruitful course of action where, for example, a person suffers injuries in custody because a doctor wasn't called soon enough, or a person harms themselves because a proper risk assessment wasn't made of that risk, and so forth. And if we could move on to the next slide, please, Quincy. These are other potential claims in the sense they are less common in this area of work, so I've put them there for completeness. The only one I really want to say a word or two about at the moment is discrimination, just to anticipate a question that might be asked or a thought that you might have. I mean, frequently clients will say as part of their concerns that they believe they were treated in the way that they were as a result of racial considerations. However, I've found over the years, although I have brought claims for race discrimination in relation to policing under both the Race Relations Act and now the Equality Act, generally it introduces a layer of complexity that is unnecessary because you can, in most instances, rely on the conventional common law course of action such as false imprisonment, malicious prosecution, and if you can establish at trial that there was a racial element involved, then that can be reflected in the amount of damages awarded in any event. So you get, as it were, the finding to that effect and the reflection compensation without going through all the complexities of the anti-discrimination legislation, which involves very tight time limits, some rather technical rules about comparators and so forth. I think I would just say very briefly there is, on the other hand, disability discrimination has proved useful. I've brought various claims for clients with disabilities that the police don't really seem to understand at all, such as autism, and are not properly treated as a result, and reasonable adjustments not made to reflect their disabilities. And that is an interesting and important area of law that isn't really reflected in other areas of claim. Moving on again. And I just say a word or two about this, because again, obviously there's a very clear interface with the criminal proceedings. Basically, if your client is convicted, however unfairly and however aggrieved they feel about that, in terms of any civil action, they're going to be in a much better position getting the conviction overturned, first of all, because a subsisting conviction creates all sorts of problems for a civil action. Firstly, as Quincy will cover, it makes malicious prosecution a no-no. In relation to other civil claims, it doesn't necessarily preclude them, but in practice, it makes them very difficult. Firstly, because of the rule against collateral challenge, which basically says that you can't bring a civil claim on the basis of a pleaded account which conflicts with the narrative upon which that same person was convicted. So your client can't be convicted of assault and then bring a civil claim saying they were the one that acted in self-defence in relation to the same events. Also, inevitably, it has an impact on credibility. It has an impact on any compensation that will be awarded if they were to succeed in a civil claim, because the two, the crime and the alleged civil tortious behaviour, are sufficiently separate. And there's also a specific provision brought in as a result of tabloid outrage about Tony Martin and that sort of situation, which provides that the permission of the court is required before somebody can bring a trespass to the person case, say false imprisonment or assault battery, where they've been convicted of a criminal imprisonable offence on the same occasion. So if I'm in the middle of burgling your house and I'm convicted of it, I can't then bring a civil claim for assault when you set about me to try and stop me burgling your house. At least I can't without permission of the court, and it's a necessary proportionality test. Next slide, please. I don't really need to say anything about, because it's kind of self-explanatory. I've already touched on the value of police complaints in the last bullet point, so if we can whiz on again, please, Quincy. Thank you very much. Again, I wasn't going to talk to this because it's a bit dense, but it's useful to have it there. Which court? More focusing on the private law side of things, as you've heard from Joel Rupert's going to talk about judicial review in due course. But in essence, as I've said over this slide and the next slide, here I've set out the technical rules, and then on the next slide, I just tried to explain in practice, you're going to be bringing a private law tort claim, the kind of course of action that I've been talking about, if it's a case that revolves around disputed facts, it's based on private law courses of action, and or if you're seeking predominantly private law remedies, damages. On the other hand, if you're challenging a decision or policy of the police on public law grounds, then you'd like to be in the admin court with a judicial review challenge of the kind that Rupert will be talking more about. Next slide, please. And if it's a private law claim, then it's either in the High Court or the County Court. Most listeners want to bring cases in the High Court because you get a better quality of judge, generally, not invariably. Particularly if you are in the area covered by Central London County Court, you will almost certainly get a better quality of judge. If you are in the High Court because you will avoid His Honour Judge Friedland, who I understand is also familiar to a number of criminal practitioners. But there are, on the face of it, quite tight rules about starting proceedings in the High Court and its value, albeit there is some discretion in essence in cases of complexity. Next slide, please. And I'm only going to talk for another couple of minutes. Who to sue? I can get asked this. Normally you sue the chief officer of police because there's nothing to be gained by suing the individual officers involved as well. And indeed, you will generally be bringing a whole heap of trouble on you and your client if you do, because it means they will be separately represented by Police Federation funded solicitors. The Police Federation always seem to have bottomless pockets and tend to take a much more adversarial and aggressive stance. So, you know, if settlement's on the cards with the Chief Officer of Police, then the individual officers and their representatives are likely to scupper it. And in most instances, vicarious liability, responsibility of the Chief Officer is not in dispute, even if the officers have acted dishonestly, fabricated evidence, suppressed evidence, what have you. Where it does become a potential issue is where an officer has done something that goes beyond anything relating to their policing functions. A most common example where vicarious liability issues arises, sexual misconduct, so officer learns of vulnerable complainant victim through their policing duties and then manipulates them into a proper sexual relationship or something like that. That's the kind of area where you get into vicarious liability issues, should be considering the individual officer or the chief officer of police, or both. Next slide, please. Just mention this because, again, it's a question I get asked a lot. Are these kind of cases generally jury trials or not? Well, as a jury trial as of right if either party asks for it. So if you want one but you are present, whoever asks for it trumps. If it's false imprisonment or malicious prosecution, say if there's an exception where, for example, complex documents involved, that's not very often invoked, that exception. However, there are tactical considerations. In the old days, 20 years ago, 15 years ago, the general thinking was if there was a dispute of fact, you went before you asked for a jury. But I think these days, and particularly in light of the kind of cross-examination tactics by defendant lawyers that I've been talking about earlier, if your client, for example, has got previous convictions, particularly if they're of a somewhat prejudicial nature in content, or the defendant's got other dirt about your client, then quite frankly, you may be better off in front of a judge who's less likely to be swayed by such material. And I certainly don't think it's a given, whereas dispute of fact, that to have a jury trial by any means. And obviously, sometimes it's pot luck in any event. Outside false imprisonment, malicious prosecution, technically, there's a power in the court to order a jury trial, but it's hardly ever exercised. So if you don't have those cause of action, you're looking at a judge alone. The next slide is damages. I'll just mention it for completeness. Basically setting out the heads of damage that you can recover in these kinds of cases. Often damages are not huge, albeit of importance to your client, but it depends. I mean, obviously, if your client's a high earner and they've lost earnings because they were in custody, they're going to get a lot more damages, or long-time loss of liberty. The key case is the Thompson case, which is a guideline case, which was introduced at a time when there have been some very high awards made by juries, and it was intended to introduce a consistency, predictability, and lower awards, all of which it's done. And the two of those matters are at least advantageous. And then the last couple of slides are about funding and costs, and I wasn't going to speak to those anyway. And the very last slide, suggested source materials, certain books and so on. Unfortunately, nearly all the books on that area, or certainly the first two which are specific to this area, are rather out of date. And anyway, since I'm involved in one of them, I could possibly tell you which is the best. But I'm going to stop there. Thank you very much.
I'm going to attempt a potted guide to the two main causes of action that you're likely to come up in relation to suing the police, false imprisonment and malicious prosecution. Assault is also a very common cause of action, but you're probably quite familiar with that. And the other one, as Heather has mentioned, is misdemeanors in public office. Turning first of all then to false imprisonment. So false imprisonment is detention without lawful justification or infliction of bodily restraint without, it's not expressly or impliedly authorised by law. So there's two elements. There's the detention and there's no lawful justification required to it. False imprisonment is concerned with the period of detention between when they're first detained, i.e. a point of arrest usually, so in the street or wherever that takes place, and the period of charge, the after charge, whether the lawful justification for the detention is provided by the courts remanding custody. So once you're charged, malicious prosecution is the relevant tort that kicks in. The issue with lawful justification is usually when the person's been wrongfully arrested. Wrongful arrest is not actually a tort in itself, although it's often incorrectly described as such. The tort is false imprisonment, but where a person's been wrongfully arrested, there won't be lawful justification. And the use of stop and search powers is the other common lawful justification for a detention. So, burden and standard proof, it's the burdens on the claimant to prove the detention. Usually not an issue if the person's been arrested, but there can be issues where detention falling short of arrest, where that might be controversial. Once the claimant proved detention, then the burden will shift to the defendant to prove the lawful justification. So I said usually arrest or exercise of stop and search power, but not always. This is a tort of strict liability, so it's no defence to show that reasonable care was taken or the person acted in good faith. So, for instance, the governor of a prison is liable where a person was detained longer than they should have been, although their sentence was calculated according to how the law was understood at the time and by the Court of Appeal, but then when the law was subsequently changed to affect the sentence calculation, the governor was liable for false prison. But the damages are more limited, where it's been a period of long period of lawful detention and then a period of unlawful detention after it. So in the case of prisoner, the damages don't equate to the police damages. Standard proof is the balance of probabilities. Dealing with detention, then, so a total restraint of someone's liberty is required. This is to be compared with Article 5, which is a different, which is concerned with deprivation of liberty, which is an autonomous concept under ECHR jurisprudence, and can be, there are circumstances where a breach of Article 5 has been found that probably wouldn't amount to false imprisonment in the domestic context. Cases involving mafiosi being restricted to small islands in Italy, they were found to be a breach of Article 5, and case against France where someone was detained in the international area of an airport and a transit land. Person doesn't need to be aware of being falsely imprisoned, so if you're unconscious you can be falsely imprisoned, but of course this will affect damages, and nominal damages are only going to be payable if the person wasn't actually aware they were being falsely imprisoned. The place is irrelevant, however. You can be detained in a car, in your own house, in a street. The false imprisonment, the detention, will include being moved from one place to another, provided you're being restrained during that movement, so from the place of arrest to the police station, for instance. But the restraint of the liberty must be within defined boundaries. There need not be a physical detention, so the police officer doesn't have to grab hold of you and say you're under arrest, enough to say you're nicked or you're going nowhere. There's no minimum period for to which amount to a false imprisonment, so a person held at gunpoint for 2 minutes was held to amount to a false imprisonment. The Court of Appeal ordered a retrial where a judge had described a false imprisonment of 30 minutes as a mere technical false imprisonment. And they, in one case, a few seconds being restricted in a doorway was held to amount to false imprisonment. Not that it would be worth suing for that per se, but that enabled or committed the claimant to use force to push past the officer, and therefore was using lawful force and not committing an assault. So with the short periods of false imprisonment, say for in terms of damages, it's not going to be worth suing, but it may well be relevant to then whether force is the claimant was entitled to use force and whether there are reasonable grounds to arrest him on that basis. Voluntary consent is a defence, so if the person attended voluntarily and they're later acquitted, there'll be no claim for false imprisonment, but it would if the voluntary attender was, for instance, locked in a room while the officer went off to check something, or told he can't leave when he says he's had enough unless he's then formally arrested. Onerous bail conditions are not sufficient, but consider Article 8.5, that may be met depending on what they involve. Deterioration in conditions is not sufficient. Prison case where they held the prisoners had no residual liberty against the governor, not the same against other prisoners or indeed against prison officers who are acting unlawfully, for instance, striking and locking prisoners up in breach of the rules of the entitlement to association stuff, because prison officers aren't allowed to strike, so that's not unlawful act in itself. Who's responsible for the false imprisonment? Merely giving information to the police doesn't make a person liable for false imprisonment, but a person will be liable if they're active in promoting and causing the detention. A direction, direct request, direct encouragement will make them potentially liable. Moving to lawful justification, section I don't very familiar with, but the primary justification relied on the police. This is section 24 of PACE. So, grounds of it. So, this section 1 dealing with current and future commission of offence. Thank you. And subsections 2 and 3 regarding the past. Reasonable grounds for suspicion. We're very familiar with the concept, but it's more than a hunch, but it's not a high threshold. It's described in one case a state of conjecture or surmise where proof is lacking. So you have reasonable suspicion at the starting point of the investigation and prima facie proof at the end, continuum. Reasonable ground suspicion has a subjective and an objective element. So did the arresting officer honestly suspect that the arrestee was guilty of the offence, and this be satisfied with briefing from other police officers? If the information they're given gives them suspicion, which is reasonably held, they can't simply be directed to arrest someone. So when there's a conflict with the evidence of the claimant, if the claimant's version is accepted, the officer, and this direct conflict with what the officer is saying happened, describing what the claimant did, then the officer can have no subjective belief in his guilt. Whether there's actual suspicion or not is a matter for the jury, and what amounts to reasonable grounds is a matter for the judge. Objective aspect is based on what a reasonable person who knew the law and material facts would consider. Where a suspect provides an explanation on arrest, this should be taken into account, and the police should assess whether they still have reasonable grounds for continuing the prosecution. Where it's based, reasonable suspicion based solely on an informant, then there's a case law saying the police should treat the information with considerable reserve. Reliance on previous convictions in themselves are not sufficient, but they can be added into the mix and easily take it across the threshold. But it, basically, if there's ostensibly reliable information coming from a third party, it's likely to satisfy the requirement of reasonable suspicion. So that's the end of the proceedings. And I've got one case that I'm pursuing at the moment where the facts of the case were so inherently implausible, although it was a third party, it was a child who complained that he'd been raped repeatedly on a school bus by another boy on the bus who'd sit at the back, and he sat at the front the whole time, and he said over a long period of time he'd been raped on this school bus. And I suggest in that case it's so inherently implausible that must go to reasonable suspicion. But in general, if you've got a reliable third party and it's not utterly implausible, then that will sign your false imprisonment claim. So the requirement of the arrest being necessary, the grounds set out here, there are the exhaustive grounds, so it has to be one of these grounds, but again, not a difficult hurdle to surmount. See, allowing the prompt and effective investigation of the offence, for instance, and code of practice G gives further guidance on this. So the officer doesn't have to be satisfied that there's no viable alternative to arrest. Rather, the case law, the Court of Appeal, is pretty limited. They just have to be satisfied it's a practical and sensible option, but they must at least consider whether voluntary attendance is practical. But in many cases, no more than a cursory consideration is required for the court. So it's satisfied if the officer concludes that the person being questioned might initially agree to being questioned, but then if it becomes difficult, decide to leave, then that would be sufficient to make the arrest necessary. But it must be based on the evidence in that case, not a generalised proposition. So there must be some individualised consideration, not a blanket policy. Limited successful cases on this. One, for instance, was a teacher who accused of assaulting a pupil with good character. He attended the police station with his solicitor by appointment for a voluntary interview, and he was arrested. There's no evidence he wasn't intending to answer all questions, and in fact he'd attended the first police station with his solicitor by appointment, been told that he was going to be arrested if he didn't accept a local resolution, and then travelled to a second police station where he was duly arrested. Another case is Lord Hanningfield, who was the member of House of Lords, who was in fact imprisoned for filling his expenses. Then there was a second investigation by the police, and because of his prior conduct of being cooperating with the police, that there was not necessary to arrest. And there's another, a Northern Irish case involving cross-border arrest of soldiers, where it said it must be more than merely convenient to the authorities. In addition to Section 24, as you know, there's obviously preserved statutory powers of arrest subject to a case which could provide lawful justification, common law powers of arrest, breach of peace, which I'm familiar with, won't go into detail here, arrest warrant and stop and search powers. So just to summarise there, lawful justification requires subjective reasonable grounds, objective reasonable grounds. It's no defence if the defendant says he could have been lawfully arrested under another power. We didn't have this power, but he could have done it another power, but that will be very relevant to damages. The arrest must be reasonably necessary. There is a discretion, but this is, I think, broadly consumed within the necessary. It is a low threshold, but consider Article 5. In my experience, unless there's a reason, there's no point in including Article 5 if it completely overlaps with the false imprisonment. You've just got a much far shorter time limitation period, and it doesn't add there may be situations where the autonomous minimum means you've got a declaration of liberty, whereas you wouldn't have a claim of false imprisonment. And it may also be relevant in terms of conduct of authorities and delay if you breach Article 5.3. So there's a case of Zanatti where the investigating authorities don't bring all the relevant information to the court's attention because of delay and being competent, your failure to bring it to the court's attention. Then the court may end up authorising detention, which doesn't have an evidential basis, so that would be arbitrary detention. So, then damages in false imprisonment. So, it's the case of Thompson and Hugh, as Heather's mentioned, guideline case. First hour is updating for inflation, £800 to £1,000. It's a sliding scale, so you don't get £1,000 for each hour, and the for 24 hours, it's £5,000. Aggravated damages and exemplary damages almost always claimed in most police cases. Aggravated damages will affect the public nature of the arrest and the humiliation abuse, and exemplary damages where there's oppressive, arbitrary, unconstitutional action. I then may move on to malicious prosecution. So this is a cause of action in relation to criminal proceedings and certain malicious civil claims that arise out of, which constitute an abuse of the legal process, but it doesn't apply to disciplinary proceedings or the majority of civil proceedings. These are the five elements of the tort: that damage was caused to the claimant as a result of a prosecution that terminated in his favour, that was brought without reasonable probable cause and with malice, and as Heather said, the right to trial by jury. So the burden, unlike false imprisonment, is on the claimant to prove balance of probability. So technically you could have a different decision on false imprisonment as opposed to malicious prosecution on the same facts and reasonable grounds to arrest, sufficient to arrest and reasonable grounds for prosecution, but you wouldn't want to be relying on the dependent on the difference in burden of proof necessity and merits. Damage, take this, is usually the least controversial element in a claim. It's almost inevitable in criminal proceedings, except for very minor offences where there's no risk of imprisonment. It can be satisfied by a loss of reputation, so if the charge is defamatory of the claimant, risk of loss, life, limb or liberty, and it's sufficient for the loss of liberty if the offence is punishable by imprisonment. You don't need to actually lose your liberty. Financial loss and foreseeable economic loss is also recoverable. What is the prosecution? So setting judicial office in motion, that's a charge or laying of information, and the person will be prosecuted even if the proceedings are subsequently discontinued. The prosecutor must be actively instrumental in putting the law in motion. The issue arises obviously with civilian complainants. Did the police or CPS exercise an independent discretion in relation to the prosecution? So the case law said a rape complainant is not a prosecutor, she was merely a witness and she didn't manipulate CPS into making a decision. And that case in 2009, the court held that following a CPS decision, an action for malicious prosecution would be rare. But for instance, in the case of prison officers and have been held to be potentially prosecutors, or the Ministry of Justice, who's precariously liable for them, held to be prosecutors, because effectively the police have no independent discretion that they could exercise. Subsequent case involving where one police officer prosecuted, charged a party on the basis of another police officer's allegations, then that police officer was still considered to be the prosecutor. The officer had been instrumental in bringing the prosecution, in substance the person responsible for the prosecution being brought. However, this recent case, that's the case of Rhys Fillery and others versus the Commission of Metropolitan Police this year. That's the Daniel Morgan murder investigation, where he's found with an axe in his head in the car park. He runs a private investigation business which sort of seemed to employ various dishonest, corrupt police officers. Fillery, the claimant Fillery, was the investigating officer who took the first witness statement from Rees, one of the other claimants, who was his friend. And Mr. Justice Mitty held in that case that the police officer would not prosecute her in the case, and in all the claims cases, including Fillery, where the only evidence against him in averting the course of justice prosecution was from a flawed witness who the police officer in charge of the case, Cook, had manipulated and had contact with when he shouldn't have, so forth. But the Mitting drew a distinction in that case between making it virtually impossible for the CPS to exercise independent discretion and making the exercise of the discretion more difficult by the deliberate concealment of an important fact. However, this is likely to be appealed. It's fairly unsatisfactory in a number of bases. He did say, the judge did say, the position might be different if the police officer responsible had deliberately suppressed information which would reveal to the CPS the prosecution had become baseless. But then again, he went on to find the prosecution against Fillery was rendered baseless, but still the police weren't the prosecutor in that case. The next slide sets out the principles which were distilled within, which are set out in Rees and Fillery, which are based on the case law, and they're what you need to be satisfied, so that they alone need the facts about any defence. Often then with a police fit-up case, that would be satisfied, the police would be the prosecutor, where they knew all the facts, they described what they say the claimant had done, and untrue, they deliberately misstate facts, intending there should be a prosecution, and so that the CPS, the other person, can't form an independent judgment. Favourable termination is required, so as Heather said, existing conviction you can't sue, but an acquittal at trial, even involving a technicality, will suffice. Claim can succeed if there was a conviction for a less serious offence other than the one for which the person was charged. And acquittal on some charges, but conviction on others, you may still have a claim for malicious prosecution on the acquittal. It's a favourable termination if the conviction is quashed on appeal. proceedings discontinued. If they're left alone on the file, it's probably an adjournment rather than a termination. In relation to stay of proceedings, probably a favourable termination where they're stayed for abuse of process, because the rule against collateral challenges doesn't apply here. And in Fillery, the case I just mentioned, the proceedings were stayed and the commissioner conceded that it was a favourable termination and the judge agreed with their concession. Acceptance of a bind over is not necessarily fatal, but if it was imposed at the end of a hearing, it would prevent it being a favourable termination. But if you accept a bind over at the beginning of a hearing and it leads to CPS dropping the case, it may not be fatal. Certainly on a strikeout application, that's what the Court of Appeal held. But in practice, the credibility of the whole malicious prosecution action will be adversely affected unless the claimant's got a good explanation for why they accepted the bind over and why that doesn't involve accepting some of the case against the prosecution case. Thank you. Reasonable probable cause. So the two aspects that need to be, either aspect that needs to be satisfied, is that either the officer had no honest belief in the claimant's guilt, that's a subjective evaluation of the officer's state of mind at the time of prosecution, and it's an issue for the jury. So where the criminal prosecution is based on accounts of officers as eyewitnesses, then it's relatively straightforward. The jury to determine which account is preferred. You'll be aware, depend on the credibility of the claimant, the witnesses, the any video footage, inconsistencies with other evidence, effectively a rerun of the criminal trial. And reliance on evidence known to be fabricated or untrue would be sufficient, but you can't infer there's no reasonable probable cause simply because there's a malicious motive. It gets more complicated where the evidence comes from a number of sources, including non-police sources, and the police didn't witness the offence. In reality, where prosecution is reliant on civilian witnesses or, for instance, forensic evidence, it's unlikely to be succeed. The other way in which there can be no reasonable and probable cause is where a person of ordinary prudence and caution would not conclude in the light of the facts, honestly believed at the time that the claimant was probably guilty of the relevant offence. So this is an objective assessment whether there's sufficient basis for prosecution on information known at the time. Set out there the steps that an ordinary prudent prosecutor would take. May be arguable that a failure to follow obvious lines of inquiry means there's no reasonable and probable cause, but it's only a question of degree, and it may be difficult to prove malice if you're relying on that that limb. Thank you. On to malice. So malice is required for this court. Malice is satisfied where the main motive is other than the desire to bring the claimant to justice. There's usually an attempt to mask the accused's own misconduct. Where there's mixed motives for bringing prosecution, the issue is what the dominant motive, and that's a question of fact for the jury. Malice is satisfied by evidence of fabrication, or you may have the actual evidence itself, like the officer saying, I know you didn't do it, you know, but I'm going to fit you up. Malice also very relevant to the issue of damages, especially exemplary damages. Then noble cause corruption, the case I've referred to in Fillory, the MPC. In that case, Justice Mitchell found there was no malice, even though in Fillory's case there was no subjective or objective reasonable and probable cause for the prosecution. He nonetheless found there was no malice because he said, although Cook, the officer's methods are open to criticism, but his motives are not. In that he was bringing those he believed to be complicit in Daniel Morgan's murder to justice. So, which is slightly hard to fit with the lack of subjective belief in reasonable probable cause, but as I say, this is being appealed. But Fillory alone succeeded in misfeasance in public office, and that shows where the two torts, where you can succeed in misfeasance, in this case because there was, but not in malicious prosecution, in this case because there was no malice, but the other elements of the tort of misfeasance, not the first limb of the tort, which required targeted malice, but the second limb, the act was unlawful and the police officer didn't have an honest belief that it was lawful, that was found to be satisfied. In that case, he breached his own guidelines and direct instructions from his superior not to be contacting this witness. There's meant to be a sterile corridor of the witness.
Can we do damages from the side? Is that okay? Is Rupert will speak to anything?
Yes, of course, yes. No, that's my last slide. So there are the damages, as you can see, from the it's a slide scale.
So, claims relating to search and seizure really falls into, as you can see, two parts. There's challenging the process, which is what I tend to do most of by way of judicial review. And then litigating for damages. And you'll litigate the damages either when you've already taken proceedings successfully for JR, usually in the search one, and you can't agree damages, or some dispute or defence raised to your claim for damages, which would be in tort. And it'll then be transferred into the county court for determination or to a judge of the Queen's Bench Division. Or when no judicial review proceedings have been brought at all, for whatever reason, most usually perhaps because you're out of time, because you have a 3-month strict time limit to bring JR proceedings. And so a challenge is then brought in and taught. It's more difficult to do because you're usually facing a hurdle of malice, certainly in relation to the procurement of a search warrant, rather than either unreasonableness in JR, Wednesday principles, or because a search warrant's issued for want of jurisdiction for one reason or another. So there's really two parts to it, and forgive me if I focus on the first, because as I say, that's what I do most of. So if we can flip through to challenging the process. Why challenge the process? Well, two broad headings there. There's the client's perspective and there's your perspective, as certainly as solicitors. Well, let's start at the beginning. How do you get these cases most of the time? You'll usually get knock on the door, telephone call, because your client or prospective client has been subject in the early hours of the morning to a raid. Obviously, that he wasn't or she wasn't expecting. They'll have had probably computers, mobile phones, documents taken away. If it's a business, the business is very unlikely, at least in the short term, to be able to operate. They may well have been subject to concurrent restraint proceedings. So in the space of a couple of hours, your client, who well, may or may not have been doing anything wrong, but has gone from running their business, living a quiet and happy life, to not having any access to funds, not having any ability to run their business, and having had their personal effects, etc., taken away. They're going to be probably fairly distraught, and they're going to want to know what you can do about it. So, moving down the client's perspective, return of the material. Well, the importance of whether it's returned or not will vary on perhaps the guilt or innocence or otherwise of your client and what they may view about it. Some are very anxious to have the material returned, others less so. And you readily appreciate that, obviously, in different categories of investigation, different types of investigation, some are more susceptible to these sort of challenges than others. So the most susceptible are plainly going to be corporate type offences, fraud, or where the potential claimant is a business or a professional, so another lawyer, solicitor, or an accountant. And then you're dealing with people who hold material in confidence with a duty to a third party. So once you've got third party rights being affected by the seizure of material, then very often you're in business, or more business than you might be, for example, if various computers have been taken away and the allegation is possession of indecent images. You can readily see that getting your computer back, even if the warrants are wrong for whatever reason, obtaining the relief of the return of that material is going to be, well, pretty much impossible. So the fraud type offences, the raids on ever more common raids on solicitors' premises or those of professionals are by far the more susceptible. Will you ever get the relief and return of the material? Well, I'll come on to that when I talk about Section 59 of the 2001 Act in a couple of slides time. The short answer is, in rare circumstances you will, or you can, and generally you have to show bad faith. Some will wish to halt the investigation, largely perhaps for the same reasons that they want the return of the material. So again, it depends on perhaps how guilty your prospective client is feeling, or how exposed they feel about what's been taken. Certainly what you can do if you get in early, and I can't stress that enough, you have to act extremely quickly if you're going to obtain injunctive relief from the High Court. Bearing in mind that your outside limit, bar something extraordinary happening, to challenge a search and seizure operation by JR is 3 months, to obtain an injunction, you really have to be in there within probably outside a couple of weeks, month at the very outside. It depends, of course, what they've done with the material. Often, of course, they seize it, throw it in the locker, and go back to reading newspapers and drinking tea in the station. So you may be lucky in that they haven't started to examine anything, or it's in a queue to be forensically imaged or whatever. If they haven't started to examine anything, well, then nothing's changed. The status quo remains the same, and you may be in business for an injunction, but don't expect them necessarily to tell you the truth or be particularly forthcoming about what they have done with the material that's been taken. Best advice is, if you've got someone who wants to challenge the warrant or the search and seizure operation, they've come to you early, is deal with it as quickly as possible. And then if you can do that, then you're much better placed to get an injunction or indeed an undertaking, which often they will give you an undertaking not to examine, simply to avoid having to go to court on an urgent application, because it would be an urgent application for which they're not prepared. From your perspective, you want to try and avoid making an urgent application as well, because you won't be in full possession of all of the facts. Pretty much all of the time you won't be in possession of that. You'll have to plead at least something. The position or the picture will then change later as you get more information, more disclosure, and you'll have to rework things. So It's not ideal. You'll be operating in a bit in a vacuum if you have to make urgent applications for injunctive relief. But if you get it, or you get the undertaking, well, your client's going to be very pleased with you, certainly very impressed, because that stops the investigation often in its tracks, and it will stop it in its tracks until, obviously, it's lifted. And if you've issued substantive proceedings and they go forward, you get permission. You're probably not going to get a final hearing in the High Court in the JR from the point of issue for about 6-8 months, a normal rate of progress. Can be quicker if it's expedited. And experience teaches these things can rumble on if there are then subsequent proceedings for Section 59, for example. Again, I'll come back to it. And what you find, and this isn't really law, it's just human nature, and you'll have experienced it yourself in long investigations, is people lose interest. The investigators lose interest. They retire. They move to a different unit. They go on long-term sick. All sorts of things happen, which means, you know, all the fun of kicking your client's door in at 6 o'clock in the morning, taking his stuff away, really has gone. And the impetus has gone out of that investigation. And it doesn't so much halt investigations as sort of make them peter out if it's drawn out for long enough. But so it's important, to have any impact on the course of the investigation, to try and ensure that nothing is being looked at while you bring these proceedings, nothing is being examined. So those two things, obviously linked, return material, halting the investigation, very much two sides of the same coin. The third reason for bringing, or your client will have for bringing proceedings, is to vindicate his rights. You've heard that mentioned already. This is the person who's genuinely aggrieved by how he's been treated at the hands of the authorities, that he's had his Article 8 rights violated, that someone's been into his house, gone through all of his personal possessions, taken them away, and he is completely innocent of any accusation. For whatever reason, often because these warrants still, even now, are obtained on the back of anonymous intelligence, which has been maliciously given. And I certainly see it, at least relatively often. They want to bring not really bothered about damages, certainly not particularly bothered about getting things back, because they just want their rights vindicated. A paradigm example is perhaps Harry Redknapp. You may remember he was prosecuted several years ago for fraud and eventually acquitted. But his house in the initial stages was raided. There wasn't, or didn't ever seem to be, any particular purpose to that, because it was a relatively small financial allegation or tax fraud. Difficult to see what the police ever thought they were going to find. In fact, having searched his house down in Poole, including his swimming pool area in the basement, they took but one item, and that was a laptop computer. And Harry always maintained that there was nothing on this computer of any relevance at all to this investigation. And indeed, when it was turned on, it contained nothing apart from an operating system. So he was absolutely right about that. He'd never used it. Oddly, you may think, the son were in attendance on ladders at 6 o'clock in the morning, taking photographs of the police as they went into his premises. How, you may wonder, did they ever discover that his premises was about to be searched? Well, there's really only one reason for that, and that's because it must have been leaked by the police. So he was rather upset about that. And brought a claim which was successful to vindicate his rights and nothing else. There's always the potential, or usually the potential, to challenge arrest and detention by way of JR as well, because most often, at the time of the search, if your client is in the premises, he'll have been arrested or she'll have been arrested at the same time. So you can challenge arrest and detention by way of JR. You often get some objection to that. From the defendant authority saying you're in the wrong court, you should bring a private law claim. Less so now, that used to be more effective than it is, because there's now been several cases where arrest and detention has been successfully challenged in the course of challenging a search warrant as well. And because it makes sense more than anything for the two things to be challenged in the same court rather than bringing separate claims via JR and also by private law proceedings. And the fourth reason, to recover damages. Usually, certainly in my experience, damages will be relatively limited and limited to trespass or value of trespass. They can be greater. I don't know what happened in the end with the Chengwiz litigation, which you may be familiar with, but there was a huge claim for damages from the SFO. And of course, there can be substantial if someone's business has been interfered with and they haven't been able to operate, and that's as a direct result of an unlawful search and seizure operation when the wherewithal to conduct the business has been taken. So that's the client's perspective. From the lawyer's perspective, well, firstly...
It's good, right, fascinating stuff, but we're 10 minutes on slide left.
All right, lawyer's perspective tends to impress the client because they may have seen other people and not many people have knowledge of how to challenge search and seizure. And it will raise your profile if you bring a successful case. Most of these cases, if not all, you get reported. So if you've done one, you'll be noticed. If you've done two, you're probably a leader in your field. If you've done three, you can take my place standing up here. So it doesn't do your profile any harm at all to bring these cases. How to challenge? Well, I've covered perhaps judicial review to a degree. You can only get a warrant quashed in High Court proceedings for judicial review. Where do you start? Well, you'll have the warrant because your client should have been given it. See how broad the search terms are. If you can't understand them properly, it seems that overbroad, there may be non-compliance with section 15 of PACE. And the application forms, you may or may not be familiar with them. You've got a copy. They are pro forma now. They weren't always, in fact, they weren't until recently as a result of the Rawlinson Hunter case a few years ago. They reflect the statutory criteria the statutory preconditions for the grant of a warrant. And if you go through it, I'm not going to go through with you now, you will see that the prompts relate. You've got a section 8 pro forma here, that's the most common form of the warrant in the Magistrates Court. You will see that they reflect the criteria that the judge has to be satisfied of before warrant an issue. Importantly, just turn to the back, section 8, duty of disclosure. Because they're ex parte applications, as in all ex parte applications, there's a duty on the applicant to provide the court with full and frank disclosure, that is, anything that would militate against the application being granted. Often, there will be matters that the police should mention to the court that they don't, either on purpose or because they are negligent. And so that can be a fruitful area. So, take that away and have a look at it, and if you've got time, compare it with the criteria in section 8. You can challenge other seizure search powers under section 18 and section 32. It's a bit more difficult because you tend not to have anything written down, and they are colloquially here and now powers that generally are not planned like search warrants, but it can be done, and sometimes it's done in the context of challenges to search warrants. Other seizures, section 19, it being the most obvious, again, it's a use of power which interferes with fundamental rights by public authority, susceptible to JR. Section 59, now is often the most common outcome to a successful challenge to a search warrant. It's used as a warrant is, so the courts have held, I don't necessarily agree with it, or the desire to do it, but the courts have held that it is a lifeboat for the unsuccessful defendant to have basically a second go at retaining your client's material, having lost in the High Court. The application's made in the Crown Court. The Crown Courts are still very unfamiliar with these. And so are the judges. They're heard by Crown Court judges who will have no real feel for applications which are similar in character and deal with proprietary rights. But that's the most common outcome of if you can't show malice or bad faith in the JR proceedings, you'll end up in a Section 59 application. You can bring your own Section 59 application if you don't think the warrant can be challenged, but you think there's been excessive seizure over and above its authorisation. You can bring your own challenge under Section 59 to get the material back. All right, I really am going to skip on now because that's what I'm most familiar with. That's the JR. So, litigating for damages. Three causes of action. Article 8, well, always engaged when a search by a public authority, and you'll be aware that you can recover damages freestanding under, at least while we have the Act, for breach of Article 8. Malicious procurement of a search warrant. Well, main difference, of course, to challenging by way of JR. Is that you have to show malice, or you talk of malicious procurement rather than unreasonableness or wanted jurisdiction. So you've got that extra bar to get to. And trespass, perhaps something of a bolt-on. Article 8, I won't go through it, the guideline case of Keegan versus the United Kingdom. malicious procurement, again, guideline case of Gibson Ray. Which you have a short synopsis of there. Be aware, if you are proceeding in tort, of the ancient Act, the only section of it left being Section 6. It's not an easy read, Section 6 of the 1750 Act to the modern eye. But effectively, what it does is it provides pretty much a complete defence in tort to a constable acting in obedience to a warrant or obedience to a warrant that hasn't been quashed by the High Court. And that's the importance, most usually, bringing the JR proceedings to get your warrant quashed, which opens the gate to a tortious claim for damages. If you don't do that, then the defendant, whilst the warranty remains valid and extant unless it is quashed, will waive Section 6 of the 1750 Act and say our constables are protected because the warrant still exists, unless they can very obviously show that they've acted beyond its authorisation. That's why you've got the obedience underlined. So be aware of that. And trespass, well, part of the common law, it doesn't matter whether the policeman is acting with the best intentions since any ticket and carriage and way back when, that makes no difference at all, and you've got various cases set out there. But as I said, trespass, pretty much a bolt-on. If you're proceeding in tort, if you succeed in malice, you're going to succeed in trespass also. And I won't try and leave the practical tips.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, we're close to the end of our time limit. I'm going to abuse my position of chair to just add one or two thoughts from my own case or two over 30 years in this field. Firstly, what we're looking for here as a criminal lawyer is a thumping win. It's very easy to get carried away when you just about win a case, your clients have pushed to win the appeal. It's very easy to say, yeah, let's sue them. But it's a cold place, is the civil law, 1 year, 2 years down the line with the Metropolitan Police sniping. So you need a solid basis, a proven lie, or in a case, myself and someone who is here, or should be here tonight, he's quite a short barrister, I can't see him, that did quite recently, the Court of Appeal saying this was a lamentable failure to disclose the material. Which brings me neatly on to my second point. Although we've titled this How to Sue the Police, it's much wider than that. Rupert's talked about suing the SFO, a series of cases I'm involved in, one settled last year, two we hope to settle this year, are about actually suing the CPS, because there's a case where the police have obtained all the material they should have done, given the CPS, and either the CPS or indeed the prosecution barrister in this case lamentably fails in their disclosure duties, then the CPS are liable, and it's a barrister, he or she, in this case actually, is possibly liable to the CPS, so you can sue the CPS and let them sort it out between themselves. And finally, and again, speaking primarily as a criminal lawyer, we always like juries, because judges, we think, are the baddies. They're against us. The juries are with us. And I echo Heather's reflections on this topic, that, again, in civil cases, my experience is quite different. Because by the time you have a thumping win with a solid basis to show misconduct by the police, by the CPS, often the judge is on your side. But if your client is the sort of person, this is a terrible generalisation, the sort of person that the police might pick on and fit up, then they may be carrying some baggage. And a tedious, exhaustive, prejudicial exploration of that baggage may have a judge putting his or her pen down looking bored, but the jury may drink it up and you may lose what seemed a winnable case. So I think these days, now that mad damages were abolished by Thompson, the Court of Appeal, I would very often think of judge, not a jury. It is now 7:30. If there are one or two questions that people are bursting to ask in a public forum such as this, please do that now. Please say what your name is. I may repeat it. So the two halves of the room, some of you may not know there are two halves of the room. There's a whole different set of people over there or over there sitting there. Do we have a question or two?
Just yes. Melanie Crudy from G.T. Stewart Sisters.
Please, thank you, Melanie. You're sitting in the front, so they will be able to hear you.
Just on the choosing a jury or not point, if you decide not to, the claimant, but won't the other side, if they've got lots of dirt, just choose themselves, or do they not have the choice?
As I mentioned before, if either party chooses a jury within, it's actually quite tight. Time limits, so sometimes you can catch the other side out, and it's not quite strictly adhered to. But if you don't want a jury because, for example, your client has a murky background, and the police do, if they ask for a jury, you can only oppose it if you can show the circumstances come within that exception I mentioned, where basically there's complex documentation or scientific material. But that's quite rare, so you will just start with it. However, I'm surprised, because I think in a lot of ways, as I'm sure our thinking has, as claimant lawyers or predominantly claimant lawyers, although the defendant's chief officer of police lawyers has evolved in quite a lot of ways, I find that they actually still generally are not too opposed to the idea of judge-only trials, which in a way is quite surprising, because I think they, for exactly the reasons that Joe and I have been saying, I think they're generally better off if a jury. But funnily enough, I'm not often, you're right, it does happen, but mostly if myself and my colleagues have advised our client not to go for a jury and he or she has accepted it, it's relatively rare for the chief officer of police lawyers to then say, oh, hang on a minute, we want a jury. Mm. Maybe partly it's cost as well. I mean, a claim is going to be much cheaper without a jury because it's shorter.
Right. One last contribution, yes, and I know you are, but announce yourself.
Sorry, Madison Gary Dastry. I was just going to actually just follow on from what Heather was saying there. I think the other way, possibly, of those sorts of situations of avoiding a jury trial if you don't want one, is where there clearly isn't any disputed facts. And so there isn't actually anything for the jury to determine at the end of it, which sometimes is the case. It's the objective element rather than the subjective element, for example, which is kind of a challenge. You might be able to say, well, look, what are the jury questions going to be when we get to the end of this trial? And if you can show there aren't any actual disputes in the jury to decide, and the only determinations are ones from the judge, you might be able to dissuade the defendant from going down the jury route.
Yet more wisdom. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming. It is now 7:30 past. Well, I mentioned, I didn't touch on it before, year after year, Doughty Street is always found to be the best, the top claimants, lawyers in action against the police by any directory, frankly worth purchasing. And possibly one or two not worth purchasing, but we'll take that to good spirit. We've only really scratched the surface, as you can tell. I feel guilty about shutting up at least two of our speakers who have a vast deal more wisdom to share with us. Please do stay for a drink. Please do keep in touch. If there are questions people have, even without formally instructing us, then there's always someone here who can discuss things, who will answer the call, and we'll be very happy to help anyone who doesn't have huge experience in this field to start acquiring just that. Thank you very much indeed for coming. Please don't hurry up.